When it comes to recovery time objectives, as well as recovery point objectives, there's multiple different ways available within the Veeam data platform to make sure you're able to achieve your SLAs. Let's hop into the Veeam data platform and show you how you get started with a replication job. Okay, so here I am in Veeam Backup and Replication. Now, the first thing that you're gonna wanna do if you're brand new to Veeam is obviously make sure you add in your virtual environment that you're looking to replicate to. So in this particular use case, I'm actually gonna be replicating to my VMware environment. So I have set up a few different hosts. I have hosts set up at my main site, and then I have hosts set up at a DR site that I would like to do replication to. Now there's two types of replication that's available within the Veeam data platform for specifically vSphere. So one of those is going to be CDP-based replication, which is continuous data protection. And if you're looking at leveraging CDP-based replication, that's going to give you the lowest of RTOs as well as the lowest of RPOs, right? So we're going to be able to replicate our workloads in a matter of seconds. We're going to have uptimes of a matter of seconds. So really, this is going to be crucial if you're looking at leveraging that for some critical SLA achievement. Now, if you want to do CDP, the one thing you'll have to do is actually deploy a VAIO filter. So this would need to be installed on the vCenter server, as well as if you have a second vCenter server that you're going to be replicating to at the secondary site, would need to be installed there as well. So you'll need to do that first in order for Veeam to be able to take advantage of that VAIO filter driver to leverage CDP-based replication. In this demo in particular, I'm actually just going to be leveraging the traditional replication that Veeam has been known for before CDP. So what we're going to do is go to our home tab. Now you'll see we have a few different jobs set up here. If I come up to the top, I could go ahead and select a replication job. So if I select my replication job, I can choose between VMware vSphere as well as Microsoft Hyper-V. In this case, my hypervisor platform is VMware. Now we're going to go ahead and create our job. So first thing you're going to do is you're going to give this a name. Now we can name this however we want. Maybe I might just name this, right, example. Why don't we call this 7 replication. And then you have some additional control options here. So number one, replica seeding. So if my secondary site had low bandwidth, I could leverage seeding so that way I can move the majority of the data over there first and then utilize that as that seed point. If I were to select that, you'll see we had an additional tab that populated here so that way I can go ahead and point those virtual machines to the seed and be able to utilize that for building out this replica at my secondary site. Now, if I have separate networks at both sites, right, if we have different virtual networks that have been stood up, then I can go ahead and do network remapping here. Again, if I check that box, we just have an additional tab that will populate so that way I can go ahead and fill in those network settings. And if we had different re-IP options that we wanted to have set up and have those virtual machines come up with the different re-IP settings, again, checking that box will automatically bring up that secondary tab, and then I can go ahead and fill out my IPs for source and target. So that way, when we create a failover plan or when we actually initiate a failover, those virtual machines are gonna come up with the right IP addresses. You also have an option down here to select whether or not you want this replication job to have higher priority. So essentially, more backup infrastructure resources are gonna be assigned to higher priority items first. Definitely a good thing to be able to utilize, especially if you have critical virtual machines that you know can't afford to miss their SLAs, specifically with replication. You can go ahead and you can check this box to make sure that those ones have that high priority option. So we're going to go ahead and hit next. This is where I can add in my virtual machines. Now, very similar to how you add in your virtual machines for backups. So you can either choose based off of VMs and templates. You can go off of data stores. I particularly like being able to leverage tags. If you use tags, then it makes it a little bit more easier when it comes to creating or updating these policies, right? So if I wanted to just go ahead and say, yep, I'm going to go ahead and leverage this particular tag, well, fantastic. Now, anytime somebody makes changes to those virtual machines or adds in a new VM with that particular tag, this replication policy is going to get automatically updated. In this particular case, I'm actually just going to select a few of my demo virtual machines that I have here. So if I were to go down to my folder, we have a few VMs in here, and we're just going to go ahead and select a few. So I'm going to add in those three machines. Now you also have some options to do some exclusions. So if you want to exclude particular disks or VMs, especially if you did a grouping in there, we could do so as well. Hit next. We're going to choose our destination. So this is going to be the host that we would like to replicate to. So in this environment, I'm going to go ahead and send it over to this location. I can go ahead and select a particular resource pool that I want to leverage for these replicas. I could also select a specific folder that we want to use to place these virtual machines in, as well as selecting a specific data store. So you have some additional options here that you can get very specific on where you want those replicas to live and what types of resources you want them to utilize. Now, if we go into job settings, there's going to be a repository where we're going to keep the replica metadata. So you'll need to make sure that you have a backup repository that's available at your secondary location. And then when it comes to the replica settings, these are going to be the last portion of what's going to be included on that replica name itself. So when it gets built over at my secondary site, you'll actually see that virtual machine, and then you'll also see the suffix that's going to be added in at the end. Restore points to keep, very similar to how we do the backups themselves, right? So you're going to have restore points that you want to have associated based off these replicas. Now, this can be very unique depending on the type of environment you have or the type of workload you have. So for most, you're going to want to keep this pretty low just because you're not going to want to keep multiple types of replicas, as generally speaking, you're going to want to fail over to the most recent data available. So 7 is fine, especially if I'm replicating on an hourly basis, then that gives me 7 hours worth of replicas that I can roll back to. There's some advanced settings in here around excluding different swap files or deleted file blocks that don't need to be included. If we want to change compression levels, storage optimization, you can also set up notifications specifically for this job, leverage VMware tool quiescence, as well as change bot tracking, which should automatically be enabled. And then there's some additional options here if you're leveraging a primary storage provider, which we can do integrations with to leverage their storage snapshots. So just keep that in mind. This is going to be limited to very specific providers. So you want to make sure that you check the Veeam Ready program to ensure that your storage provider will support this. And then you have some options in here to add in any scripts, whether you want to have that run before the job or after the job. Next, we're going to go ahead and have the option to do data transfer. So this could be direct, which is going to be just the automatic setting chosen. But then you also have the option to leverage a WAN accelerator, which you'll just have to create 2 separate WAN accelerators, one on each site. This will just do an additional caching to making sure we're not sending any duplicated blocks over the network. So this will help to, I wouldn't say increase bandwidth, it's just going to ensure that we're not sending duplicates amounts of data that we don't need. You should always have at least 1 proxy at the source and 1 proxy at the target. So that is going to be highly recommended regardless if it's CDP or regular replication. You want to have at least 2 proxies that are going to be handling communication to both sites and the storage that it has access to, and then running the replication job between both of those. Next, you're going to be able to select guest processing. So if any of my virtual machines had included Windows-based application, right, where we want to enable application word processing. Let's say it was a Microsoft SQL database, for example. I go ahead and check this box. We can ensure that we're processing that data as best fit to ensure that we have a transactionally consistent replica that's sitting over at our secondary site. And then we'll go to our schedule. So this is where you can select to run your job automatically. So I can set this to run daily at particular points in time. We can do this monthly, periodically would be probably more sufficient for a replication job because I'm going to be running this, you know, let's say maybe every 2 hours or so for these workloads, or maybe I want to run this every hour or every 4 hours, just depending on what is that data loss going to look like for what I require from my business standpoint. Here, these are pretty low changing workloads themselves. So I'm going to go ahead and set this to 2 hours. We'll have those automatic retry methods in here as well. And I can even set a backup window or a termination window for when that data can actually be processed. We're going to go ahead and hit next. This backup job or this replication job actually gets created here. We could see all of the settings. And if I check this box, we could go ahead and run this job once I click finish, right? So once we hit finish, you should see that new tab populated here. We have this new replication job. It includes those three virtual machines that I had chosen. And if I want to go ahead and start this, we can go ahead and see this process kind of kick off. Now, once my replicas are completed and I have replicated them over successfully over to my secondary site, then I'll also see an additional tab that'll populate here that's gonna show my replicas, and it's gonna show them available for me to start initiating any types of failovers or creating failover plans. And then if you wanna get really particular, right? You can actually leverage Veeam Recovery Orchestrator to create some richer documentation around how you want to initiate your failovers within replicas, as well as testing those replicas to validate that they're hitting the SLAs that you need. So we could go down here to this last 24 hours, and we could go ahead and hit statistics, and we can see how this replication job is running. Now, as you can see, we have these three virtual machines that are being replicated across. Now, what the replication is doing in this sense is it's actually taking a snapshot. So we're going to take a snapshot from VMware. We're going to create that snapshot. It's going to get processed over, sent to our secondary site, and that's how we're going to use to actually create that replica over at our secondary location. So what you're seeing here in these statistics settings is just that process of how that's being created, right? So the VM snapshot being created, processing the configuration, using that source proxy to go ahead and start processing the data over to our targets. And then once that's completed, the removal of the snapshot as well as deletion of any of those swap files or file blocks as well. And once that's processed and complete, then we get that nice successful window. And that's going to be the process that happens here. So still leverages a snapshot from within the replication, but we consolidate that once it's completed. So just one thing to kind of point out, right, that there's going to be two differences between traditional replication, which is leveraging that VMware snapshot, and the CDP replication, which is not leveraging a snapshot. It's actually going to be leveraging that VAIO filter driver that we discussed right in the beginning of this demo series. But as mentioned, it's pretty quick, right? Especially for those three machines. It took about 6-ish minutes to go ahead and process all of those. Once the processing is done, I'm going to go ahead and hit OK. We can go ahead and we can see that replication job was successful. It completed. But then on top of that, now I have this secondary tab here for my replicas, and I can actually see my replicas that are sitting inside of this ready state. So that way, if I want to go ahead and initiate any failovers, I can do that. And now the one thing I will call out is there's going to be a few different options for you to choose from when it comes to initiating a failover. So we can either do a failover now, which will just automatically power on that replica that's sitting at the secondary side. I could do a planned failover, which will do one last final snapshot of my source machines and then copy any of those changes over to my replicas and then power off the source machine, followed by powering on the replica that's at the secondary site. So planned failovers are very helpful, especially if you're looking to utilize this for specific tests that you want to have initiated. Once you initiate a failover, you have the option to run that as a temporary state, and then you'll have your options to make it permanent. So that can be either doing a fail back to production, where you're going to have everything run in failover mode for a slight period of time until once you get everything at your source site fixed and up and ready, then you could merge all those changes back. You can do switchovers. You also have options to undo those failbacks. So that way, if things didn't go right when you initiated the failback to production, then you can swap that right over. And then you have your option to actually commit the failback, which means we're going to make that permanent and migrate any of those changes that were made when it was sitting in failover mode back to production. And then you simply have the option to just undo failover, disregard or get rid of any changes that were made to that virtual machine replica when it was sitting inside of that failover mode. So a lot of different options available in here, but then also being able to create a failover plan. I'm sure we'll probably walk through this more extensively inside of an upcoming demo. Thank you for joining this series for how we walk through to create a replication job. Be sure to stay tuned when we go over some of the additional tips that you can utilize in order to create better data protection policies within Veeam Data Platform.